What is a data model? Remember it in a simple way. All the tables are related with some sort of joins, okay? So when we model an entire database, so based on the relationship between the tables, okay? So like the primary key foreign key relationship will be there, okay? So based on that, we try to conceptualize the complete model and try to join. Then there are different concepts which are there, like, you know, a one to many. There are many tables which are dependent on one table. Okay, same happens in case of like normalization, which we discussed earlier. So it's simply, it's a diagrammatic representation. And then there are some particular notations through which we generate the, I mean, we try to, when we say something is primary key, okay, when we define it, so it will be, table name will be on the top of that. Then under that, the primary key will be there. Then all the columns will be there. Most commonly used is the Erwin tool, okay. In the industry, which is written here, the data modeling tool, there are others also which are available. Now, data modeling is something which will be done before and will be presented to the ETL tester. So as a tester, you can refer to it, but you are not going to, you know, make any suggestions or anything. That what is given to you is already finalized. Now there are different types of modeling. Okay, so even when the architects start the data modeling, they will go in three phases. Okay, so there is conceptual modeling, there is logical modeling, and there is a physical modeling. So we'll just see in details what are these. Out of which the logical and physical ones are the important. Physical modeling is something which, you know, even can be asked in interviews. So initially you get only the raw data from the business, just the requirements. You have to understand what, why they are trying to create it. Based on that, you will decide how many tables and everything can be created. So when we say entity means tables in database language, attributes are our columns, and the relations are obviously the keys. So based on their business, like in the retail, we can have, you know, sales, customer, product tables. So likewise, depending on the business and the domain, they will first decide how many tables can be there, and in a particular table, how many columns needs to be there. So this is all on a very high level, a logical modeling. Okay, there will be 100 tables. In 100 tables, every table can have, you know, different columns. So this all will be decided. And here, the particular name of the table will not be there. They will just give it, you know, some business names to the tables and the entities. Then again, it is independent of the technology. At that point of time, you don't know whether you are going to create a DB2 or Oracle or Teradata. So it's just independent of, at that time, you will just decide, and later on you will try to implement on a different set of technology. And again, it is normalized to, you know, even like a 4NF. 4NF, don't get confused with that term. Practically, it don't exist. It just, they mean to say that it's completely normalized, okay? Whatever relations you can think between the tables, okay, to the lowest level they will try to break. Okay, these many tables can be there, these tables will be linked like this. So it will be all into the normalized form. Now when the actual physical modeling comes, this is where the database structure gets written, okay? So the database administrator will actually publish the data definition languages, the DDLs, into the database. So when this happens, you have to include the name for all the tables, the name for all the columns, the keys, most importantly, the data types. The data types are not defined in the previous models, okay? Then any validation rule, database triggers, stored procedures. So these are our database terms, right? At a particular event of time, you can, you know, always trigger a database trigger which will do some particular action, insert, updates. So these kind of things will be there. So this is all depend, but major thing is you will always have the table names, column names, and their data types, and all the validation rules, in the sense all the keys will be linked. So this is the most important, where you have to give it the actual names. Then again, whatever standard you are following in that project, and as per the database management system you are using, you can, you know, further refine it. It includes the primary keys and indexes for fast data access. So everything you have to define. So like Teradata is there, there the concept of primary key is not there. You have the concept of primary index, secondary index there. Okay, it's a different database technology. In Oracle, it is primary key, foreign key, like that. DB2 also for primary key, foreign key. So based on that, and also the indexes would be defined. So this diagram will make it very clear to you, and this is how in reality it will be published. So the Erwin tool generates it like this, and likewise the other tools also going to be generated like this only. So it will be like a kind of screenshot in a Microsoft Paint or something, which you will open and just, you know, it will be too big in the real project, so you just slide it and just try to view the table which you are testing. So what is important to know here is, in a particular data warehouse, you may get 3 or 4 tables to test during that project. So you need to understand how these 4 tables are linked to the business, linked to the other tables. What can be different relations? When you are not able to find the mapping document, then you try to understand how the ETL flow will be there. Okay, these 2 tables are joined, then that means how the data will flow here. This is the fact table. Okay, this is the dimension table. But before going into very detail, let's just see how it is published. So generally, the end product is physical model. You won't get to see the logical end all. When the complete data model is created, always you will get the physical model to see. So the definition which we just saw, you will define, okay, this is my time dimension, this is my product dimension in logical. Date will be my key, product ID will be my key. Then what can be the different, in a time table or in a product table, what different things? Obviously, the product name will be there. The description would be there, category will be there, then the price, and like these are the logical things which you can think, okay, these columns should be there in my this table. And my fact table is my sales, so sales will obviously have the primary key of all the dimension tables. So like date ID is there, that is the foreign key now in this table, right, okay.
Manish, similarly, sorry for interrupting, yeah. Can you please maximize the PowerPoint slide, so can you please run the slide.
Second. Hold 1 minute, 1 minute.
You have 5. That's perfect.
Yeah, I think it's better now, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So the whole concept is, yeah, tell me.
Where is data model, Manish?
Sorry, say that again.
So who will be designing the data model?
See, data model will be designed by, there's a specific role called data modeler, okay. There are specific jobs for data modeling. Even an architect can do this, okay. But for that, you should have the knowledge of a particular tool. So generally, this will be done by, you know, high-end people. Even at times, business analysts also do. But developer and tester will never do it, okay.
Okay.
So it is not the task of the development and testing team. But yes, it is a very important document to refer while developing the code and even also while testing the code.
So the tool name is Erwin, right? One of the two.
Yeah, tool name is Erwin. Erwin is the most popular one. There are other also, like Microsoft Visio is there, and a couple of names we saw in this slide. Like Erwin, Oracle Designer is there, Power Designer. Even I heard first time this Power Designer, Oracle Designer. Most popular is Erwin and Microsoft Visio. So these are the tools maximum you will find.
Okay.
So Manish, this will be started after requirement phase?
Yes. See, the requirement phase is the first one.
Yes.
So where you know, everything, the requirements has to be freezed first. Then only you can go into the actual conceptual model. Then we'll try to visualize, okay, these many tables should be there. This is how they will be linked. What could be the primary key? So in a product table, naturally it is the product ID which has to be the primary key. If product ID alone cannot do, then you will think of composite primary key. So all this knowledge to the data modeler business will give. Okay, because I am running my business, so I know, you know, what data is important. So we will tell it, and this is the technology based on which they will create the product for you. Simple. So this is just for understanding. Okay, this is how the logical model looks like initially. Then when we comes to physical model, okay, we initially thought that product should be there. So product table should be there, but what would be the actual name of the product table in the data warehouse? So you will call it like dim underscore product. So dim means dimensional table. So dimensional table generally are referred with dim underscore like that. And fact table will be fact underscore something. So this is kind of notation just to, you know, easy understanding. So now data type is the important which we have to define in the, see, physical means it's the physical table with you. You are actually into the database now. You can do SQL queries, or it could be initially empty table, but you have to load the data into that. So when you do that, you have to actually publish the DDL, full definition. This is also a very important test case. So the first test case when you start your retail testing is to verify the table structure with respect to data model or with respect to the requirement document. All this will be given. So you will first do it like this, describe table command in the database. The table will be published in the database, the complete structure, and then you will see, okay, if date ID is integer, then whether it is integer or not. Similarly, product ID is integer defined, it has to be. If not, then this is also a defect which we have to report. So here if you see, all the columns are there with respect to their data type. Date description, where care 30, month ID, integer, so everything will be there. Then in the top you will see the table name will be there. Then the rectangular box is there where your primary key would be there. And under that big box, your all column names would be there. So this is how the data model looks like. Then these arrows will be there with the dot. So they are pointing that there is now many to one relationship. So there are many dimension tables which are linked to one fact table. Okay, so all these links will be there. So that means definitely these tables they have to be joined to the fact table. Okay, so that day we saw in the example, so how we make the, you know, joins. So join will be based on these key items. Store ID equal to the store ID of the dimension store. Okay, with respect to fact, then product ID, then date ID, all these primary key, foreign key will be joined. And then we have item sold, sales amount. So this is just for concepts. Okay, actually you have to just refer the document, try to understand. This is how the data model should look like. So we'll move to next slide.
What will be the document name, Manish? Data design document or?
For this document, no, it will be data model.
Data model. Okay.
So at any point of time, you have the complete right to ask for the data model. Okay, while you are testing, you can straight away ask business or your manager simply that I want to refer a data model for better understanding. Can you please provide me that? Okay. So this is like a mandatory document. It will be there in all the ETL projects. It's just that when is the need to refer that, you will ask for it. So we can see some theoretical part here, logical versus physical. So logical represents the business information and defines business rules, and physical is actual physical implementation of the model in a database. Okay. Then here we call it like logical is entity, here we call it like table. It's the actual table name and everything we give. Attribute, column. Primary key constraint, alternate key, then there are different keys which we can define, index, okay, check constraint, default value, these are all typical database terms for a particular table. The relationship has to be converted into a foreign key. If there is any definition, you can give it in a comment. So this is all while you create the table, you give. So when you like create table name as select this column, so there you can give even the definition of every column. In Oracle, you do it by comment, okay, and there are other databases, there is SAS database, in that you do by the name title, okay, so there are different ways just for, you know, understanding. So now, there are two types of modeling which I told you, like ER modeling, which is majorly for OLTP systems, and dimensional modeling. Dimensional modeling means, always remember, dimension fact table. That is what the data warehouse schema is. That is why what for data warehouse are meant for. So ER data modeling is used in OLTP systems which are transaction oriented. Focus of OLTP design, individual data elements, data relationships, and design goals are accurately model business and remove redundancy, normalized. So OLTP will always be normalized. Okay. because of so many transactions and so many things happening on every single day. And data warehouse become redundant over a period of time. That's why initially we start with star schema, and later they will be converted to a Snowflake schema. So some of the shortcomings, what could be there? See, again, why we say it is a complex, because again, general reason for this is, first, the business is not much involved. You are not doing any reporting on top of that, okay? So nothing that sort of, decision making you are doing. So business people are unfamiliar with that. History is never maintained in that, okay? Or even if history will be maintained, it will be of a few days or maybe 1 month maximum, okay? A lot of insert, update, deletes happening at a very regular interval. It's complex at that time to imagine the status of the data over a period of time. And then at times it could be slow query performance also. So when we come to dimensional modeling, it's a complete logical data model you will create first before doing the actual physical model. The complete why this table name, why these many columns, why this column is the primary key, why the composite primary key, everything will be there. So logical data model used to represent the measures and dimensions that pertain to one or more business subject areas. Dimensional model is equal to star schema to start with. Can easily translate into multidimensional database design if required, overcomes ER design shortcomings. So again, by seeing the model only, we can, it's completely understandable, right? It was very simple. You have the table name, you have the column names defined, everything is there, data type is there, primary key is defined, the relationships are defined, systematically represents the history, reliable join paths are given. So those arrows which were given, so these are your join paths. Okay, these are your join paths. Okay. And this has to be defined very clearly in the data model. So it's very easy to refer. And then it's denormalized high performance query. And then again, it's enterprise-wise scalability. So see, today you create a star schema. Obviously, your business will grow over a period of time. Your data warehouse model cannot be constant. Today you created 100 tables. Okay, loaded the data, you are doing business. After 2-3 years, the tables may go double. They may go 200. So they will keep on adding on the. So you don't have to create a new data model. You will just see the relationship with the existing tables, and you will put it in the same data model. So that is why it's enterprise-wide scalable. So in data modeling, we generally use the term, multidimensional cubes, 3D representation of data, everything. So this is more of the BI part. So when you do the business intelligence reporting, like the tools are there, Cognos, business objects. So these concepts of cubes and all are typical there. You actually create a particular view of the data. You create a particular view of the report. So that is more into that side. So in details, we need not to discuss. And here there are only particular tables where you are querying and getting it. Then again, in data warehouse, data will always be denormalized unless you are converting into Snowflake. And when you create into Snowflake, only some of the dimension tables are normalized. It's not the all the dimension tables which will be normalized. Okay. So denormalization is the term which is associated with data warehouse or likewise a data mart. So again, in ER modeling, there is no center table. Okay, there is no star schema, there is no Snowflake schema there. So all the tables will be joined in a sequential manner, like in a several tables and chains of relationships among them. So it's difficult. That's why it becomes complex to understand. But in data warehouse, there will be few tables, and fact tables are connected to the dimension table. There could be many dimension table to a particular fact table. So it's like a star in star format or snowflake format, easy to comprehend. So a very detailed level of transactional data would be there, every data transaction. Here only the aggregates and measures. So basically we refer to the fact table. Fact table is our core table where the business measures will be there. Okay, like the items sold, that aggregation will be there. So such kind of things we drive. So aggregates and measures will be there. Then there would be only some kind of normal reporting in ER, but data warehouses are meant for reporting. So these drag and drop, multi-dimensional OLAP reports, these are, in itself is a big development for reports. So when the BI developer does it in business objects or Cognos, so this is, entirely different project. So you have to create these many. When your ETL part is over, okay, when your ETL code is into production, then only on top of that you can do the reporting. So then that is a different project will go. There will be separate BIT.
Well, Manish, in data warehouse, can we have more than one fact table?
Yes, why not? There would be always. There would be many fact tables, in fact. Okay.
So, one fact table will be related to another fact table, or will be there any relationship between them? Is it like that?
Yes, the fact tables can be connected together also.
Okay.
You will see that also later.
Okay, Manish, thank you.
So dimension table is one that describe the business entities of an enterprise. Okay, represent as hierarchical categorical information such as time, departments, locations, and products. Dimension tables are sometimes called lookup or reference tables also. So one dimension table could be a reference table for some other table. So this is just a definition, but you if you can visualize the data model and always you can. So this is the important thing. Okay, it describes the business entities. Obviously, what kind of business you are doing, all that information will be in dimension table. What measurement or logic you are driving out of that will be in your fact table. So it represents the information such as time, departments, locations, and products. So just try to remember that. These are the different dimensions. So again, there would be so many theoretical things will be attached with the dimension table. So we'll just walk through it. So again, it holds the dimension attributes. Means that means the product table will have the different columns. It usually have a large number of columns. Attributes are columns. Obviously, in your business is big, right? You talk about Walmart. Walmart sells so many different products. So the product table will be so big you cannot even imagine. It will be definitely normalized. Product will be joined to product subcategory. In subcategory, there would be other many categories so they can define. So likewise, they will have so many columns. Then again, just to understand the data, at times you will have like flags, indicators, okay, and you have small number of rows in comparison to the fact tables most of the time. Okay, surrogate key is something which we'll just discuss a little bit now, but again, this is something which will be discussed in in the remaining of the classes, because when we talk about all the SQL joins in dimension table with respect to the dimension table and fact tables, it is actually the surrogate key based on which we make the joins and not the primary key. So why this is required, and I'll tell you this concept now briefly. See, first let's go through the definition. It's a unique primary key generated by the relational database management system that is not derived from any data in the database and whose only significance is to act as the primary key. A surrogate key is frequently a sequential number. Each table assigned a unique primary key specifically generated for data warehouse. So the first question which comes to the mind is, when there is always already a primary key defined, what is the need of another primary key? Okay. And this is true for dimension tables, not fact tables. Fact tables can have sometimes, but that's a rare scenarios. So don't even think in that direction. Just think of dimension tables. A dimension table will always have a surrogate key. Okay. So what happens from source, you are extracting the data, okay, from source to staging. From staging, you are loading the data in the warehouse, in the star schema. So how the data gets loaded? Always the dimension tables will be loaded first. And then the data goes into the fetch table. Okay. So what is the primary purpose of data warehouse? To maintain the history. Data is never deleted. It will always be amended. So slowly the dimensions will have, the same data will be changed, it's coming again. Okay, you are storing the data. So what happens? The primary key will get repeated in that case. So you are doing a fresh insert, and when the data is changed, you are also updating it. Okay, and you will close the previous record, make the new record as the open. We'll discuss these open records, closed records in a slowly changing dimension type 2. So I'll give you an example. Okay, try to visualize this example. Suppose you are in you are working in a company. Okay, so you have employee ID, you have your name. So these are the things, you have your location where you are working, right? So what is the thing which can change out of these three? Obviously your employee ID will not change, your name will not change, but location is something you can, if that will be changed. So today you are working in, say, Bangalore, you may move to Chennai, okay, after 4 months. So your location is getting changed. So in data warehouse, you have to maintain the history. Okay, if they want to see in last 5 years how many transfers you had, so all your locations should be there. Okay, so how the entry will be there in the dimension table initially if surrogate key is not there. Today you joined the company in Bangalore. Okay, so your employee ID will be there. That is your prime, obviously that is the primary key. Okay, for employee table, your name will be there, your location will be there. So right now I'm considering these three columns. After say 5 months, 6 months, now you are moved to Chennai, a different location. So you want to update this information in the table. So once you update the, and also you have to maintain the history, remember, otherwise you will simply update, you will go and you will change Bangalore to Chennai. But if your manager wants to see how many locations you have changed, it will always show the current location, previous data will not be there. So when you maintain the history, you have to keep Bangalore also, Chennai also. Okay. So how it does, there is a concept called start date and end date, which is always there. Date columns are always be there in that dimension table. So start date, today, okay, 26th September, you joined the company. Okay, that date will be your start date. End date will be open date, like some 31st December 9999. Now, after a month, okay, say next month, 26th October, you are going to other location. So how it will be done is, your, again you will create a row in the table, your employee ID will be there, your name will be there, your location Chennai will be there, your start date would be 26th October, end date would be again 31-12-9999. But the previous end date, okay, which was open, that will be closed with 26th September. That means that record is closed. Your current location is Chennai. So that record will have an open date. So what is the problem here? The problem here is your employee ID gets repeated twice. You cannot change that. So that is a primary key violation. Your primary key can never be duplicate. Okay. It will immediately throw an error. While creating table, you have defined it primary key. So as per the definition of primary key, it cannot be duplicated. So to avoid this, that there is another column which database administrator will create in dimension tables, because dimension tables are meant to get, you know, their basic purpose is to, you know, keep the history. So obviously things will be duplicated. All right. So primary key, they will, like in Informatica, there is a transformation called sequence generator. So sequence, every time a row is, new row is inserted, it will generate a new sequence like 1, 2, 3, and it has some limit of in lakhs, millions, okay. So when the surrogate key is implemented, initially your data when it entered, okay, when you join the company, say you get the primary key, you get the surrogate key 10 that time, there are previous entries also. After 6 months, when it gets a new row, there will be some sequence number. It will be different from 10. It could, at that point of time, depending on how many entries are there in the table, you will get a fresh sequence number, which is our surrogate. So with respect to surrogate key, your both entries of Bangalore and Chennai are not duplicate, because when we make a join to the fact table, the surrogate key will come into picture. Surrogate key will come into picture along with other keys. So it doesn't make it duplicate for you. Every time it's going to be unique. So you see here, employee ID is the primary key. Employee name is there, title is there, department ID is there. So did you get some idea of surrogate key? I will show you with the tables also, but since in slide this topic came, I didn't want to cover it right now. So this is just one of the reasons I have told you why we need surrogate key. There are other logical reasons also. So again, this is how the dimension tables generally are there, okay. Based on the model key is basically your that particular table key will be there. There are dimensions, and then in the center there is a fact table. So slowly changing dimensions. So surrogate key generally comes into picture with slowly changing dimension type 2. Type 2 is what where we make history. So dimensions source data may change over a time. Obviously it will change over a time. Okay. Like we just had the example, the location of an employee is never going to be constant. At some point of time, it's very likely to be changed. So these dimension records change slowly over a period of time. So when we implement SCD, okay, so definitely it will allow you to maintain the history in the type 2 category. So this is just another example. If a woman gets married, possible changes to customer dimension, what it could be? Obviously her last name can get changed after marriage. Marriage status will be something which will be changed. Address is something which can change. Household income is something which can, you know, keeps on changing. So based on your business, you will define what columns are likely to change. Based on those columns only, you maintain the history. Guys, any questions till now? Srinivas, you watch?
No, Manish, I'm good.
Okay. So, this is the most important part of our course. Okay. So, while working for data warehouse, either development or testing, we have to understand slowly changing dimensions. And there are three types of it, out of which type 2 is very, very important. This is where we maintain the history, and you will always see SCD type 2 will be implemented. This is a typical question for ETL developer or ETL tester. How will you develop a type 2 SCD? How will you test a type 2 SCD? What could be different test scenarios which will you write? How you have tested SCD type 2? Okay. So this question will always be asked, and you have to answer it perfectly to, you know, show the confidence. So to developer, they will ask which tool you are using in your project, say Informatica. Using Informatica, how did you create the SCD type 2? What all transformations could be there? How the data was updated? How the data was inserted? As a tester, what kind of different scenarios you wrote? So you will say like, I wrote insert scenario, update scenario, delete scenario. I checked the surrogate key was properly implemented. There were no duplicacy. At one point of time, only one record should open. One record should be there with open date. Like the end date should be high date. And previous entries of that record should be closed over a period of time whenever he changes his location. Okay. So this is how you will always tell. There can only be a single current record in a table. Previous record's end date will be closed. The day on which he changes the address or location, it will be get closed by the new date. So these are the different high level test scenarios which you are going to write. Then you will convert these test cases, test scenarios into test cases. Like you will write the actual SQL query, whether the insert of data is happening properly. So this all we will see in actual, I'll show you the insert updates, everything when we start our practicals next week by logging into the database. Okay. And then we will try to, see the test cases, inserts, updates, everything. So this is a very detailed topic. This is just to mention at this point of time. So STD type 1, we don't maintain any history. What it does, it updates the existing record with modifications, does not maintain history. So what happens is, try to think like that. In initial load, there are 100 records in a table. Okay. Then next day you are doing a daily load. Delta records are, we generally call it delta load, increment, or you call it incremental load. There are 10 records coming. So what happens first? The existing 100 records which got loaded on day one, they will be there in some, there is a lookup table. Okay, so lookup table is nothing, a reference table on top of the target table. So before you insert or update anything, you have to compare those 10 records with those 100 records. So in the lookup table, first you will convert. Lookup table will have at a point of time the complete information of the target table. So first, what will you see? Whether these 10 records are already existing in the target table or not. First check, the ETL code will do this. If the records are not there, simply you will insert it in any dimension, in any type 1, type 2, type 3. If records are not there, already those 10 records, primary key you will see. You will try to match the primary key with the, and here the primary key means business primary key, not the surrogate key. So the, because in source there is no surrogate key. So only the, based on the primary key, like employee ID, you will try to match. Okay, 100 employees joined the company on day one. Next day, 10 more employees are coming. So any duplicacy is there or not? So first you will see employee ID. You will try to match with the 100 IDs next day. So okay, these all are new employees. So you will simply insert it. Then you will see from source, the data has come. Some employee ID 100. Oh, this employee ID 100 we had yesterday itself, but this record has come from source again. Then you will see, next check is there any change? So in any change in the rest of the attributes, so like employee address, location, name, marital status, everything. So in location you will see, in location there is a change now. Okay, so yesterday when we did the initial load, the location was say Bangalore, now it is say Bombay. So you have to now maintain this thing. So business will define which table has to be type 1, type 2, type 3. They will tell you that's how we will design the ETL code for that requirement. So if it is type 1 table, so what we will do, we will simply update the location from Bangalore to Bombay. Okay, so previous history is not maintained. Simply, simple update. So this is our type 1. It will update the existing record with modification. So location has been modified and updated. Next is type 2. Again, same example we will take. Day 1, 100 records came. Okay. Day 2, from source, 10 records are coming. First, you will see 10 records are existing or not. If they are not existing, simply insert it. Okay. If they are existing, then you will see what are the changes. If changes are not there, you will reject it because you need not to make the entry again. Okay. that time you will just update the process date. So if changes are there in the location, so what you will do, first you will insert the changed record, then out of those 10 records, whichever record is the, you know, already you will find some changes in the target, you will first insert it. Then you will update the existing record, and how you update in SCD type 2, the end date you will close with today's date, because today there is some change. So yesterday it was say 25th September. So start date will be 25th September for existing record, end date will get closed with today's date, which is 26th September, and the new entry will have obviously start date today's date, because today you are inserting it, and end date would be open date, because next time you don't know when he will change the location. So at a particular time, only one single record will be open, okay, for a particular employee. The rest all will be closed. So when you query the table, you will always have the previous information also. So that's what it says. Adds new record, it does maintain history, and it maintains old record. Okay. Again, type 3 will just keep today's value and yesterday's value, just one previous entry, that's it. So keeps old and new values in the existing row, requires a design change. So here what we have, we generally have a previous date or previous column this created in the table. So if any record gets changed today, okay, so it will just contain one previous day, means just the last information, okay, what was it. So only one previous history it will maintain, that's all, not all. So that is the concept of type 3. Type 3 is rarely implemented in practical, okay. You will either see type 1 or type 2, and mostly type 2. Dimension tables will always going to be type 2, except some of the dimension tables, they don't want to maintain history, they will make it as type 1. So type 3 is in practical, you will rarely see it. So it's 80% type 2, otherwise it will be type 1, 20%. So this generally they create a column called previous value column in the table. So whenever the new record is coming and it is already existing in the table and there is some change also, okay, so the record which was there already in the table, they will move it to the previous value column. Okay, say your location was Bangalore, so they will move it to previous column. Today your location is Chennai, they will update is Chennai. That's it, simple. At any given point of time, there won't be more than two instances of the history. Simple, that's it. So any questions in type 1, type 2, type 3?
Yeah, I have a quick question, Manish. So
yes,
like you said, there are two, three types. So is there any specific transformation it will be tested in the type 1, or a specific transformation for a type 2 or a type 3, or all the transformation will be taken care of all the types?
Yes, no, there are different transformations are involved. Again, see, transformation is something part of your mapping, okay. Different ETL tools, different designing. With respect to Informatica, like there is a transformation called update strategy. Okay, so update strategy, you in there, you define the strategy, how to insert a record, how to update a record, how to delete a record. So that is the one of the most important transformation. In practical, you don't test the transformation, okay. What you are going to test is your insert query, your update query, whether in table the business logic is implemented or not, irrespective of how developer has done using ETL2 and which ETL2, it doesn't matter, it could be data stage also, ab initio also, okay. So there are different tools, different ways of implementing the SCD type 2 logic. With respect to Informatica, it's the update strategy transformation which is very important. There is lookup transformation, there is a sequence generator transformation which will create the sequence. So there are many transformations which are involved. There will be sorting of data, there will be some filtering of data, okay, sorter, filter, update strategy, sequence generator, lookup, these are the some common which will be 100% they are going to be there. Okay, there will be expression transformation, you will try to modify some logic. So that's how the entire mapping will go. So when you write test case, you don't write test case on the transformation. Okay, I'll test lookup, I'll test no. You have to write your test scenarios which we discussed, and on top of then you break down into test cases.
Okay.
Yes, if you see some differences, okay, if you see the insert is not happening properly, if you see the update has not happened properly, you can always open the mapping and see how developer has created it. But it's not necessary, you will always have access to that code, okay, in projects, but mostly you will get it. So you get the read-only access, okay, in development environment. So in dev environment, from directory where you are migrated, you will go and just from your knowledge, just for to debug it, you will see. Because it will be easy for you while raising the defect, you can pinpoint. It will be helpful for developer also. But it's not mandatory to do that, okay. So what is important is that your SQL has to be perfect. All the filter condition, all your insert logical, these updates and group by whatever is required in that, that needs to be there perfectly. But for your knowledge and just to see it, you can always see the code also. And if you are running the code, okay, so if the code itself might fail, if it's not written properly for insert update, so you can catch it then and there itself in QA. But again, this depends from project to project. Whether you are the one who is going to run the code in QA and populate the data, or is it some other team will do it for you, and when it is done data load, you will they will simply ask you to, you know, test the data. So generally in big organizations and in big projects, you won't get a chance to load the data yourself, because that is something ideally it's not a tester's job. Your job is to test the logic. Okay. There will be separate environment team who takes care of Unix servers, ETL schedulers. So they will schedule the job, they will check the scheduling. Okay, at this time job is running, is it loading the data or not? Developer does the unit testing. And if they don't have the budget to have a separate environment team, most likely it is the developer who is going to load the data for you in QA. They will run the job, whether it's loading correct or incorrect, they don't know. Because they do unit testing, that too, unit testing is not always done. They don't have that much time. So whatever unit testing they will do, they will check with very few records, okay. They will take a sample 500 records, 50 records. They will just check, okay, data is getting loaded. Then with huge volume of data in QA, you will load the records and then you do the testing.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, Manish, say for example, we have written a query to test particular mapping scenario. So will be there someone to review that query, or is that we who has to finalize it? Because maybe sometimes the query may be wrong, right?
See, SQL queries, it's very difficult to write 100% correct before the actual execution. Okay.
Okay.
It has to be though 90% correct. Okay. Why I'm saying that anyone will say this is 100% correct is it's very difficult to say, because when the actual data will come into the tables, okay, huge data, I'm talking the proper QA data, then you will run your SQL query. So you have to modify your query little bit, but that is only a 10% part, or 20% maximum. See, when the mapping document comes or the data model document is there with you, seeing that you will write your SQL queries. Okay. Mapping document, sometimes they keeps on updating. They will update it, okay, this was a mistake, this was wrongly written in that, or we missed this condition. If the mapping team itself or the architect itself is forward to give you that filter condition or some joint condition, obviously how will you write it? Developer may also develop a wrong code also. So when it is not matching with business or you know, sometimes the defect gets cached in UAT, in system testing, SIT it should be passed. Because business will test with UAT data. They will directly take it from production, they will test it. So just by seeing the data in the table, they will tell you this is a defect. The data cannot be there because they are domain experts. Okay, so banking project, they know all their products, terms with respect to loan, mortgages, retail banking, corporate banking, core banking. So they know all the things. So UAT people will just see. So then you have to backtrack it. Why the defect was not caught in SIT? It will come to test manager. He will pull his team. Okay, why you didn't test it this? How come you skipped this? Then you will show your test cases. I covered all the scenarios. then you will go to the mapping document whether this was there. So then you have to backtrack it. Then there will be some changes they will implement in the code. So at that time they will just do it in development, directly move the code to UAT. You don't test it in the lower environment. Testing is always done in you know, from lower environment to higher environment, not vice versa. Once the code has moved to high environment, you won't test it in the lower environment. Okay, so yes, test cases are reviewed. Your SQL queries will always be reviewed by someone who is senior in the team. Okay, maybe he is at the same level of you, but he is an old timer in the project. So he knows the project well. So he may review it, your test lead may review it, your test manager, whether at offshore or whether at on-site, they may review it. Okay. At times, a developer can review your SQLs also. Your manager will say, okay, send it to the development lead. He wants to see whether at least you have covered all the scenarios or not. So you have to write proper SQL, you have to update in the tool and everything. But yes, here and there, one or two conditions you may not have written, which you can always add at the runtime. When you are running your query, you will find, okay, this mistake is there. Because queries are big, okay, there could be syntax error also, small here and there. So unless until you run the query, you will never know whether your query is running perfectly. But logic-wise, it should be complete. Whatever is there in mapping, how many joins are mentioned, how many lookups are there, how many reference tables are there, everything should be included in your query. Syntax-wise, error is always acceptable. Nobody will say anything. Runtime, you please correct it and run your query. So review does happen. At least in terms of scenario coverage, review 100% will happen. In terms of what SQL you have written, you may not get that much time to review SQL line by line. But like SCD type 2, all the scenarios have you covered or not? Whether your table structure test case is there or not, count structure, count matching is there or not, duplicate check, primary key foreign key relationship check, all the business logic for every column that is included or not. So these things will be definitely checked.
Okay.
Yeah. So these are more theoretical terms now with respect to dimensions, like degenerated dimensions. We have confirmed dimensions. I think I'll cover this in a later thing, because these are not relevant at this point of time. These are very theoretical. You won't even get the idea. When we see the practical part and data model, I'll try to cover if these things will come. Practically, these things don't come into picture. So these are more related to the data modeling and all these things. So as of now, I'm skipping these things. Okay, degenerated dimension, confirmed dimension, they don't come into picture in your practical time. But theoretically, sometimes, they have given these names. But when we see the actual testing, we'll try to cover this thing. So right now, just by reading this and this, you won't be able to understand. Okay, fact table. A fact table consists of the measurements, metrics, or facts of a business process. That is what we have seen. Okay. Then there is a lowest level of details would be there. So what is a grain in database terms is the level of detail represented by a row in the fact table. It must be identified early. So what kind of measurement are you going to start? So in a sales table that we saw in a retail project, obviously, the sum of items sold, the price, that sum you will always try to maintain daily basis, weekly, monthly. So remember, fact table. Whenever somebody asks what is a fact table, you will always just say two things. Okay. It will have the keys of all the dimension tables, which is the composite key of the composite primary key of the particular fact table. So there are four dimension tables, the four keys composite together will be the primary key of the fact table. And then the basic purpose is to have the measurements for that particular business, what kind of facts you are storing. At times there is a term called factless fact table. Okay. So in that there are no facts stored, but what we store are like counts. So daily you log into Facebook or Twitter, okay. So they want to see, okay. So Facebook generally they try to maintain this thing that the user has logged in how many times, Okay, they want to see the popularity of their product. How many times you are logging in, checking in. So those number of logins on a particular day, they will count and keep it in a fact table. So that doesn't have any business meaning here. Okay, that doesn't have any measurement here. So you are just trying to collect the count. So your product, something is going, you are going to Flipkart, any website, you are clicking on a particular product. So they will just say, okay, this user has clicked this many times. So that means they will try to get some business meaning. So this product could be popular, or my website is popular. There could be similar websites, right? There are so many e-commerce websites. So that is how the, you know, data is being retrieved. So there, when a particular event is happening, okay, so you are clicking, the counts are, so these are like factless fact tables. So this term is generally, you know, come into picture. So again, there would be dimension tables, and then there would be sale facts. There would be, first there would be, so these are the three tables, 1, 2, 3, and there, these are the three keys. Model key, dealer key, time key for three tables. Then what could be the measures? Revenue, quantity. So there are different categories like fully additive, semi additive, not get confused much with these, just try to read that. They can be fully additive means that everything can be summed up. Okay, it can be summed across any and all dimensions. Stored in fact table, example, revenue, quantity, sales amount. There are some semi-additive which may not be summed up with respect to all the dimensions which are involved. Some of the dimension tables, but not for the others. Non-additive, something which cannot be like weather, age. You cannot add these things, right? You cannot have an aggregation on these things. Now, schemas in data warehouses. Okay. If you go for a definition of relational database, what is a schema? So generally, when we log into the database, I will show you, and you may be knowing by this time. So a set of tables are assigned to a particular schema. Okay. So say you have a development schema, you have a QA schema. In QA schema, all the QA tables will be there. Development schema, this. So you can create this type of schemas. Then schemas could be on, say, based on the business, you can create it. Okay. There could be a product schema, all the product tables will be there. There could be a geography schema, all the different geography tables you have created. So these kind of, there, in short, there will be different schemas just to, you know, have a set of tables. So the definition for a relational database is, a schema is a collection of database objects including tables, views. Views are also nothing but a table only. It is a subset of a particular set of data. Indexes and synonyms associated with that. There is a variety of ways of arranging schema objects in the schema models designed for data warehousing. So in data, see, don't get confused with database schema. Database schema is something which you create, is a collection of database in this. When in the interview they will ask you, okay, in which schema your warehouse was, so you have to answer star schema, snowflake schema. So we discussed this star schema. The definition is very simple. It just says that it is the simplest style of data warehouse schema. Star schema consists of one or more fact tables referencing any number of dimension table. Dimension table could be 2, 3, 4, 5. Generally, it will be 3 to 4 always. What is the advantage? Obviously, they provide very highly optimized performance for typical star schemas. Well-defined, denormalized tables. Okay. So, when you do the querying, the performance would be high. Then again, it is supported by a large number of business intelligence tools. So, this is how your star schema would look like. See this diagram. First, always see the dimension tables. There's a time dimension is a default dimension. It will always be there for any schema. Because over a period of time only you are maintaining history. So time schema is the default schema. then there would be different, you have opened different branch, okay, then there are different locations, there is different items. Then again, you will see item table and location table are further normalized, okay. So you have broke down into, there is a supplier table which is linked to item. So supplier table has supplier key, but supplier type is the extra column which we are maintaining here. And this supplier key is linked to the item. Likewise, location can have location key, street, city key. Based on the city key, you are generating a new table called city. In that city key will be have a relation with location, and then name of city, state or province, country, all these you will move to the city table. And in location, you will just keep the location key and the street name. You won't key other things. Ideally, your city is also part of location, right? So today I ask you, what is your location? There would be a location key assigned to you, for you in the location table. In which street you are living, that will be there. In which city you are there, that will be there. In which state or province, that will be there, and obviously the country will be there. So these kind of information, you know, kind of become very redundant. So they will try to break, okay, city, state and country, they have some kind of relation. I can group this thing and put in another table. But what would be my primary key for this table? City key. City key is already there in location key. So you will join it like this. So here we have to understand how the tables are getting broken into smaller tables, why we are doing it, how we are doing it, and then we are joining it, right? In practical, this all will be done by business users, architect, data modelers, business analyst, and the client itself will tell you this is how it is done. It's not our job, but yes, we have to understand the concept behind this. It will help us to write our SQL queries. Then there's a center fact table. So time key, item key, branch key, location key, these all are now foreign keys, okay, which are coming here. Together, compositely, these are the primary key of the sales fact table. Then business will decide what all things they want to measure. Obviously, units sold you will measure, dollars sold, how many revenues getting generated, how many products are getting sold, and then what could be the average sale, there will be create average sales column table. So like that, it depends what they want. So fact table will have always the keys of the dimension tables, okay, and the measurement columns it will have, simple, and remaining is the dimension. So this is a very simple but a very good diagram.
Manish,
see all the slides and yeah, tell me.
Yeah, after creating, we'll create data warehouse using these schemas, right? So once we break the data warehouse into data marts, is it will we design the same schemas over there, or it is just like a simple database?
See, data mart is nothing, it's just a view on top of the data warehouse. Okay,
okay, just like a view.
So,
okay.
Exactly, just a view. So you will have a restricted access only for HR department or finance department. So okay, that replica will be there. Okay. So you don't create anything extra in there.
Okay.
At times you don't have data warehouse, you only have data marts. Different data marts you will create, and because when the business is small, you will say, okay, I have source, I have my staging area, after staging I'll create 4 or 5 data marts. So you'll individually test those data marts. But mostly when you talk about EDW, enterprise-wide data warehouse, which is going to be most likely when you are working with big clients, okay. So they'll first create EDW, after that they'll create some data marts on.
So data marts is something like views, or it's a database?
It is a database only, but the information which is there
in the
data mart is also there in data warehouse. Okay. Just for the querying purpose, just for the security restriction of access, okay, you will create on top, and just for the user it will be very easy, end user, okay, his queries will be fast, reports will be fast on top of that. So they will create separate data parts based on that subject area. Data is already refined in warehouse, remember that. But warehouse is having all enterprise-wide data.
Enterprise-wide.
To put some security, okay, why the HR person will access to finance data? So just create a data mart for HR or separately, okay. So data mart will always get refreshed from data warehouse only. So the, how the ETL jobs will be there, from source to staging to warehouse. Then from warehouse to data mart also, there would be one ETL job. So any changes happening in the data warehouse for HR department tables will get refreshed for data mart also.
Okay.
So data mart is also a physical database only. but it is having the view of your warehouse only at the end of the day. It's not like the database view which I'm saying, okay?
Okay.
It's definitely it's a physical database.
One more thing, Manish.
Yes.
Coming to the previous slide, there is a in city there is a city column in the location dimension table.
Uh-huh.
City key. So you are dividing it into breaking down into further table like city
correct.
Table.
Correct.
So this city table will always be in the normalized form, right? I mean the dimensional tables which are derived from other dimension tables.
Basically, it's not the city table which is normalized; it's the location table which we have normalized.
Okay, the location.
So initially,
we are organizing it. Okay.
Initially, the location table will have all the columns: location key, street, city key, city, state, and country.
Okay.
So after a period of time, you will see the kind of data it is coming. This is the third normal form, right? So you will always see that. Always see that city, state, and country are directly depending on the city key.
City.
They are not depending on the location. They are depending on the city key directly. So you will see, okay, these columns I can break into a separate table. And let me create a city key, primary key. See, try to remember it like this. Okay, I'll start again. This is very important to understand. Initial dimension table is location table. So what is the prime? Obviously, for a table, first thing what you will do is you will define a primary key. Correct?
Yes.
What is the primary key for location? Location key. Okay. Then what are the other columns? This is the key column. Other columns are street, city, state, country. City key is not the column initially in the table.
Yes.
Because city key we are creating for the city table when we are breaking it. Then
yes,
there has to be a primary key foreign key relationship also. Then you will create that column in the location. So location table becomes the child table. Parent table is city table with respect to city key column. So this is parent-child relationship.
Okay.
Now, when you observe the table, so this is just very simple tables, right? In business terms, it's very difficult to understand, like in you see a banking table. It's very difficult for you to understand the banking terms completely. And in a project, you never get that much time that you acquire domain knowledge. As a ETL tester or developer, you will be doing the technical part. So functional knowledge is very difficult to get. You have to spend a long time in the project, then only you will get it. So at a period of time, what you observed is that city, state, and country, these three can be linked together. So for this, you decided to create a city table. Obviously, you will give a key column to city also, which is city key. But to join location and city, the city key column has to be there in location also as a foreign key.
Yes.
So that is how you link it, that is how you break it. But who does the breaking is business. You don't do it. But you have to understand how these tables are joined. What is the breaking concept? Why do we break it? Okay.
Okay, Manish, you got it. Thank you.
Yeah. So next slide, designing a star schema. Well, we'll take a small break first, okay? Then we'll start ahead. Let's take a 10-minute break, okay?
Okay, Ramesh.
Right, so...
You want to end the session?
No, no, I don't want to end the session. I'll cover more also, okay? So maybe another 20 or 30 minutes we will discuss for today.
Okay.
Okay, so let's take around approximately 10 minutes break. And then I'll be back, and we will, start further. So I'm just stop sharing the screen right now.
Okay, we'll be in the
okay.
same session, right?
Hello. I'm sorry, what?
We'll be in the same session, right? We don't want to exit the meeting and again connect it.
No, don't want to exit. Just is that we'll talk after 10 minutes from the further. So be in the same session. Leave your laptop as it is. Okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Thanks.
Okay, finish.
Yeah, Manish.
Okay, so shall we start now? Both are there, na?
How about Srinivas? I don't know. Is it here?
Srinivas, let me ping. Is it 10 minutes or less? So Yuvraj,
yeah,
I have a question for you.
Yeah, please.
So I just want to understand, like you have a 5-6 years of manual testing experience. What exactly you guys test in manual testing? Like what kind of scenarios you have there, or what kind of testing like you have performed? Generally, it's like I understand it's application testing, right? Some application for a bank or website, something like that. So
yeah.
What kind of scenarios you write there?
So the normal case is we'll be getting like how we get the requirement, and we'll be mostly did a database testing. So what I do is, so based on the requirement, I'll be just checking the data by inserting the data in the backend, and I'll be verifying the data in the front end. So it might be a Java
okay.
or a .NET application.
Okay.
So
but you don't test with SQL, is it?
Yeah, I tested with the SQL, not like how we do in the ETL, that is like loading a data and
okay.
I did some data like loading, like inserting a data in the backend, and I will be checking with the front-end application.
The front-end application, okay, okay.
So that we can check how the application behaves.
Okay. I think Srinivas is not responding to ping. Srinivas, are you there?
So you are sharing the screen from Hyderabad or from Bangalore, Manish?
I was in Bangalore. Now I have traveled to my hometown, Gurgaon.
Oh,
okay.
Okay.
Yeah. Yesterday morning I reached Gurgaon.
Okay. Okay.
So I will be working from Gurgaon for a couple of months now.
Mm-hmm.
So right now I am at home. Okay. So there is a Wipro office in Gurgaon also.
Oh,
so for a few hours I'll go there in weekdays.
Oh, okay. Okay. So this is your breakfast time, whereas my time is a dinner time.
Which part of US you are there?
I am from Bellevue, Seattle, Washington.
Oh, Seattle?
Yeah.
Okay, okay. My close friend is there in Microsoft there, Seattle. He went through TCS, then he joined Microsoft after a few years.
Hub, right? Microsoft Hub.
Yeah, that's what he says. There are so many buildings he has not seen in 4 or 5 years total. Yeah, very Srinivas. I don't have his number also.
I guess I have his number.
Can you ping his number? I'll call him from my mobile. Okay, I'll just call him. Yeah, Yuvraj, he is coming now.
Okay.
Yeah, just wait for a minute, I think, for him to join.
Yeah.
So see, now I'll be taking classes from home only. So in weekend also, if required, we can extend. Okay, if there's nothing you can understand, maybe during practical classes we need to spend a little more time. So we can easily have now, you know, at least 1.5 hour class daily basis. We can take break in between 10-15 minutes after 45 minutes or 1 hour. Then we can again continue for half an hour, 45 minutes from Monday onwards. So I will make a plan in proper for next week. Theoretical, much of the things required initially to start with ETL testing is what I'm trying to cover. Otherwise, concepts are generally huge, okay? There are theoretical books also. So this is what at least you should understand or know, is what my purpose is. Out of it, mostly things I have covered. What would be remaining, I will see over weekend, and if required, I'll cover or try to finish it on Monday class. And then as soon as we will jump on to SQL.
Okay. So in which situation, in which criteria the Unix comes in, Manish?
See, Unix can come in. Unix will mostly come in all the ETL projects because your Informatica will be installed on Unix. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So that is one thing. Ab initio is another ETL tool which works on Unix, right? So Unix will mostly be there. All your code and everything will be there. Teradata scripts will be there in Unix. Okay. So, but that Unix knowledge is at base level only is required. There could be around 10 to 15 very important commands which I will give you.
Okay.
So that we have to understand.
Right. So regarding
your... So Shivas, you are there now?
Yeah, Manish, I'm back.
Okay, great. Yeah, please ask your question.
So regarding the Teradata, it's kind of a SQL or it's what is the...
Teradata SQL is different SQL than Oracle, but yeah, they are almost 80% similar. Okay, but the database server which operates is completely different. And Teradata is designed specifically for warehouse, much popular than Oracle. Okay.
Okay.
Oracle has Oracle Exadata in the market, okay, which is for data warehousing purpose. But Teradata has gained immense popularity, and it's actually very nice. It's the best tool which I have worked so far. Okay.
What is
it? And then it's the Teradata itself. I'm telling the Teradata utilities and the Teradata database.
Okay.
SQL syntax-wise is almost same. There would be little bit different in syntax, some concepts.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I would say with respect to SQL, whether it's Oracle SQL or DB2 SQL or Microsoft SQL Server or Teradata, SQL is around 70-80% same only.
Okay.
Here and there some syntax will be different and some joins and all these things will be different, indexes will be different. Okay. So such difference will be there. But if you know the basic SQL, Oracle SQL, it's more than sufficient. You can pick up any other SQL very quickly.
Because when I have a chance to look up the some of the requirements for ETL testing and a data warehouse testing, in the requirements they have mentioned that SQL knowledge is preferred and Teradata will be added a plus or it will be a preferred.
Teradata will always be very much added. If you just write Teradata in your CV,
uh-huh.
First of all, there are very less people in the market for with Teradata skills. Okay.
Okay.
Again, there are less people who get chance to work on Teradata. So I worked with four AT&T data warehouse 3 years back.
Okay.
So AT&T data warehouse is completely on Teradata. It's the world's second largest data warehouse after Walmart. So Walmart has the biggest data warehouse in the world. Second is AT&T US. Mm-hmm. Okay, Walmart is also US. Okay, so that was completely on whereas such a big data model that, you know, even people with the five year plus of experience working in the same project, they have just seen 30-40% of the data model. It's so huge.
So Walmart
so that was an enhancement. Walmart, I'm not sure. It's client of Wipro also.
Okay.
But I'm not sure on which platform their warehouse is. Probably it will be in Teradata only because such large EDW only Teradata can handle.
Okay.
Nowadays this IBM Netezza has come, Oracle Exadata has come. Okay. And IBM DB2 itself and Microsoft SQL Server. But SQL Server works for small projects. Okay, it cannot handle large databases.
So the Netezza is an IBM tool, right? When I have a chance to look into some documents on the Netezza, it started with some server concepts.
See, NetEase, not sure how does it work. It's less projects only in NetEase, so not many clients are using it.
Oh,
okay. Mostly you will find Teradata, IBM DB2,
okay,
and Microsoft SQL Server. These three. Oracle will be there, but Oracle will be generally, you know, staging part or source will be there in Oracle. Target warehouse in Oracle is very less because it cannot handle huge data, right? Over a period of time, it will fail if initially it is successful for a few years.
Because when I was talking to my friend, he was telling, so basically with the ETL concept, it is not only the structured query language. Nowadays, it's, there are unstructured data. So like...
Definitely. Big data has come into picture.
Yeah, now the clients are looking for a database like NoSQL, MongoDB kind of a thing.
Correct, exactly. So these things, these are very hot in the market. They have recently projects started to come into these big data, Hadoop, and there's a NoSQL, MongoDB. So this is something which will be one of the sources for you to extract the data. Okay.
Okay.
In the warehouse. So you're extracting data from Hadoop. So you will be using NoSQL, other technologies, MapReduce, there are different things. So you should understand that part. So there will be a particular team who will be working on Hadoop only. They will extracting, transferring data from that and loading it. There will be other teams. So data comes from so many places from warehouse.
Okay.
Right. But again, that is a different technology. So to you know, extract data from Hadoop and all this thing, you should know some Java knowledge is required, some different. So again, there at a certain point of time, you know, you don't know what project you are getting. But ETL in itself is very huge. That is something which is advanced. Once you know ETL, you are working on ETL, you can always try to learn new things.
So being on a safer side, by learning SQL, additionally we need to learn another one or two DBs, it will be safer side, am I right?
See, right now, just for your benefit, I will cover Teradata basics in this ETL. Because that won't take much time for me. I'll take 1 hour. I'll cover Teradata architecture. I'll tell the difference between Teradata and Oracle architecture. I'll tell some of the basic Teradata utilities, what they does.
Right.
And I can show you some Unix scripts of Teradata from my AT&T project.
Sure,
okay.
Sure.
So that will at least, you can say in interview that I know this. Okay. If you know the architecture, you can always be confident. Because Teradata, I know it's very important. Once you write it in your CV, you will get so many calls for that.
Okay. Yeah, when I was talking to my friend, he was telling I was learning some ETL data warehousing. He said, if you learn Teradata, it will be really good and you can get a job easily.
Yes, even you know, I didn't get chance from last 2 years to work on Teradata. I was looking for a project, but somehow I got in. I read, you know, Informatica, then SQL Server Integration Services, Microsoft project. So that's how in service company, they will give you any project in other different technologies also. Your domain will be data warehousing consultant. But you may get project across different technologies, right? That's how you know the Indian companies, service companies work, any service company. Okay.
That's right.
So, but yes, my personal choice is Teradata and Informatica to learn. And I've been sure if you get a chance, that is also very popular tool. And generally you don't get documentation on the internet. It's a very highly costly tool. Licenses, you know, has a very high cost. Very big banking clients use it. See, the concepts will always remain same. It's just that hands-on experience on that tool. So sometimes they prefer, but again, jobs are less, people are also less.
Okay.
Maximum jobs will be there in Informatica, Teradata, and ETL testing. If you go into this field, right? So yes, we'll always you know, discuss these things more while we prepare for the interviews and all.
Yeah, so
let's cover a little bit more today. So designing a star schema now, what are the things which comes to your mind while you design a star schema? First of all, you will identify what all the columns which can change over a period of time. So 5 initial design steps based on Kimball is the one who proposed the data warehousing model. Okay. So let us see the project life cycle here, in what order they are designing. So first of all, you identify what kind of facts you want to measure. You will design a fact table. You will try to name it with respect to subject area. at what level you want to do the aggregation. That has to be that you call grain, fat table grain. Identify various dimensions which can be attached to the fat table. Identify all the attributes, okay, all the columns for that particular dimension. Okay. I think that is there in this slide. Yeah, this slide is complete. I'll send these all study materials, you know, important ones in a zip folder later on to you guys once we cover some significant portion of the course. Okay. And in the meantime, what you can do is always whatever topics we are covering, little bit, at least try to spend 1 hour over the internet also. Try to come up with questions. Okay, because what you learned in class, you will see on internet and then you will get more doubts. You may get a better definition also there. Okay. So we can always casually discuss for 15-20 minutes in any class, whatever we have covered. So try to spend 1 hour or net. Try to see different definitions. Try to see, like you are seeing ETL testing jobs, what are required, okay, in US. Likewise, you can always, you know, try to search what is there, and then we can cover some topics outside the syllabus also required for the interview. Like Teradata is one. I have worked on Teradata, so I can very well explain you Teradata architecture, primary index, secondary index concepts, okay, why Teradata is different from Oracle. So this is something extra, but very, very important required. Okay, it's just an addition. So such things you can always bring in the class, and we can have a discussion on that, right? Whatever will be there in my knowledge, I will cover that, which is important, over and above the course content of this module. Okay, so I'll try to set up the now practical classes, mostly say from Tuesday. Monday, I'll see what are remaining theoretical concepts are remaining, okay? Or else if required, this slowly changing dimension, I'll try to cover in more detail on Monday class. Okay, with respect to tables and all, I will show you some other slides which I have. So, okay, because that is more very important to start with. Fine. So we'll have regular classes from Monday, 7:30 sharp. Okay, minimum 1.5 hours on a daily basis. 1 to 1.5 hours we'll cover everything. So try to go through this over Sunday a little bit, what we discussed, and let's at least come up with some of the questions. I think this should be okay for today. Anything you want to ask, guys?
I am good for the day, Manish.
Good for today?
Yeah.
Right. Theek hai, Yuvraj Srinivas, we'll catch up on Monday morning, okay? And we'll proceed further then. Fine?
Okay. So Monday, Indian time, right?
Yeah, Indian time, morning 7:30. So I think you both are comfortable with this time. Do you want some change in time? Then let me know.
Okay.
Both of you. Okay. If you want, please, if it can be delayed from 7:30, it is better. Early, it would be difficult for me. Okay. So, yeah.
If there is any your project release or something, you just ask the organizer to let us inform before at least 30 minutes or 20 minutes before. So not the 5 minutes before, so that you will be ready for
that I will do. Yeah, because last couple of days in Bangalore I was very busy, so okay. That's why I could not inform on time. That definitely I'll tell you. Okay.
Sure.
But today I was thinking it class will start from 10 because I asked them, but initially they told 7 to 10. I heard from 10 that you want because today is holiday, right? That's right. So no problem in that. I'll definitely inform them a day before. Okay. And if you guys want any change in times, then let me know. Okay,
sure.
Otherwise, right, as of now, 7:30 morning India time, we will start on Monday, okay?
Sure. So likewise, okay. my kind suggestion is from here onwards, we'll be having like a same, like we have like an interaction section. So that it will be good form, so that we'll be discuss some ideas on the intro session.
Definitely. In every class, in a particular topic, what they can interview us, I'll cover then and there itself. Rather than in the end, we will cover interview classes, no. At the same time, anything comes to my mind, I'll just try you to tell you guys that you please note it down. This
sure.
is important. This is your class. Okay.
Okay.
So, take access for remote machine and all. I think Gangadhar will provide you next week. Okay, and then we will log in, and practically also you can do like half an hour. I can teach half an hour. You guys can practice, and we can see. So we will try to spend time on these things. Fine.
Sure, Manish.
Okay, so I'm disconnecting today's session, and let's meet on Monday morning, 9:30.
Okay.
Yeah. Manish, bye. Yeah. Good day. Bye.